Hello, everybody. Welcome to One for the Other podcast. It's a podcast where we talk about movies. We talk about music. The two things that only really matter in life, you know? You know, the movies and the music.
That's it. That's all that matters.
That's all that life has to offer. I'm Lane. That is the other one. What's the other one's name?
I haven't decided. It's just the other one.
The other one. Lane and the other one. I'm Lane, that's Josh, and we're going to talk about a record and a movie that we suggested last week to each other. So, I suggested the record last week, and I suggested the 1968 live record. This is the first live record that we've done.
It is. It's also the first time we suggested a record, and the person suggesting it hasn't heard it, but the other person has.
That is very true. I don't know why I hadn't listened to this record prior to this point, but I have now, so suck my small wiener. It's a 1968 live record at Folsom Prison by Johnny Cage. So, fucking, yeah, since you have explained your background with this record and, like, did you like it before, and did like listening to it again make you appreciate it more or less, or what'd you think?
So I first listened to this record in like a year ago, I think. I took a history of rock class and we looked at a bunch of different genres, including stuff like Johnny Cash, and I was like, wow, that sounds cool. I also watched a video about it. Polyphonic made a video on this album in particular, so I had heard good things and sounded good, so I gave it a listen and enjoyed it then, and I definitely still enjoyed it this time. I picked up on some new things, but overall my impression did not really change too much. What about you? Did it live up to the expectations you had?
I think it totally fucking did, and more. I didn't think it was going to be so goddamn funny. There are so many moments in this record where it's just like, I don't know, Johnny Cash just has like the perfect personality to perform at a prison. So it's like the perfect blend of, like, you know, him just bullshitting on stage and him bullshitting during the songs and him like laughing during the songs. It just sounds like they had a lot of fun performing this record. And, well, I guess they performed, I was reading up on it, and I guess they did a morning performance and a night performance. So some of the songs are taken from the first or second performance. Huh. So that's kind of interesting. They just took the best one of each performance. But it worked out, and it seemed really seamless, and, like, it didn't, like, cut, like, right as the song started or anything, which was cool.
Yeah, and like, the way he, like, is funny and talks to all of them is something that initially drew me to this album that year ago, was that, like, the humanization of people in prison. Like, it's a whole theme on the album. Look at just the track list alone, you can see what he's singing. So, like, that's a really big theme, and I think that's really awesome that he would go to do that. It's interesting seeing, because, you know, Johnny Cash is obviously known for being, like, I would say early country. And I don't think that's something, like, the humanization of people in prison would be something you would see in a lot of modern country music. So I thought that was very interesting.
Definitely not. And especially in 1968, like, that's fucking crazy. Like, I don't understand how, like, the logistics behind that. But I guess when you are Johnny fucking Cash, you can just be like, hey, I want to perform there. And they're like, okay. Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Well, and just looking at the Wikipedia, they've played a couple, they did a couple albums from prison shows, so this wasn't even just like a, oh, I'll do this and it'll be cool. It was like something he really cared about and did multiple times, and yeah. I'm sure he performed in prisons other times than recording for these albums.
Probably, you know, yeah.
He mentions it. Being in Folsom Prison on the album. He said, last time I was here.
Yeah. Yeah, and I just love, oh my god, one of my favorite moments on the record There are so many that I want to talk about, but one in particular is from the last song, Greystone Chapel. And he's like, yeah, one of the prisoners fucking wrote this song, and I'm going to sing it, and I hope I don't fuck it up. It's like, yeah. What? Could you imagine writing a song in prison and, like, sending it to Johnny Cash? Just be like, huh, yeah, I heard you coming here. Could take give a look-see. And then he fucking sings it, and it's, like, a really good song.
Yes, it's a really, really good song.
Like, holy fuck, I would shit my pants. Like, oh my god. That would make my life forever if Johnny Cash sung my fucking song. Just some dude in prison. Yeah. That was fucking dope.
It's definitely wild. I do know this from that video I watched, though. You know, like, obviously the audience you can hear very clearly in this, and it plays a lot into the energy of the album, but you know the one, like, whoop after the Reno line?
Yeah. I was reading something about that on Spotify, like the Genius thing.
Yeah, apparently it's fake.
Yeah, didn't they edited it in? Because... because, like, they were actually too scared to whoop at that line or something?
Yeah. I think that makes me a little bit sad, just because, like,
yeah,
that's semi-famous from the album, is that whoop, but it's not even, like, it didn't really happen, but...
Yeah, it's all right. Another one of my favorite moments is when he gets done with, like, this emotional ballad. I can't remember which song it is, but, at like, as... I don't know if it's because of how it was edited or whatever, but it's, like... As soon as he strums the last chord of the fucking song, he's like, can I get a glass of water? And he's like, I need a glass of water. Please, I need a glass of water. And he's just like going on about it for like 2 minutes. And they won't give him a fucking glass of water.
And he talks about how shitty the water is.
Yeah.
He's like ran off his boots.
Yeah.
And he's like, can I get it in not a tin cup?
Yeah.
I'm Johnny Cash.
Oh, that's my God. Like,
There's a funny moment on Nirvana's MTV Unplugged.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember exactly what it is, but Kurt is asking for something. And he's like, aren't we a big fucking rock band? Why don't we have all this?
It's hilarious, the oversights of, you know, people who set up performances for these huge people. It's like, it's an expectation for them. And... Yeah, I just thought it was funny that he had to ask for a glass of water and just how he did it. He was just like, oh, fuck, I'm fucking so fucking thirsty. I need to ask right now after the song ends. Oh, fuck.
Yeah, and you know what else is funny? And this was something I didn't notice until, like, even partway through this week of listening to this album.
Mm-hmm.
But in between The Wall and Dirty Old Egg Sucking Dog,
mm-hmm.
he says... And play a few love type songs, and then proceeds to sing a song about wanting to kill his dog and then flush from the bathroom of your heart.
Yeah. Oh my god. And I fucking love that fucking song. That. Oh yeah, Jax. Oh my god, yeah. Holy shit. Is there any, like, I don't think there are any true love songs after he says that.
Give My Love to Roses right after Jackson's,
okay. Yeah.
And that's kind of...
It's more like, I'm dying, give my shit to my wife. It's sweet, though. I like that song.
Yeah, that song is... A lot of this album is really sad.
Like, yeah.
The content matter, that one, Green Green Grass of Home makes me want to fucking bawl.
Jesus Christ. That gave me a little... Whew! Little sweaty eyeballs there.
Yeah, but speaking of Give My Love to Rose, something that I, like, thought about when listening to it this time was the interesting songwriting choice. I don't know if Johnny Cash wrote this or not, but...
I think Hank Williams wrote it.
Well, it's a very interesting how the song focuses entirely on the dying guy, and mm-hmm. none of it is about Johnny Cash's character.
Yeah.
I think that... You could easily, like, explore that as well, and you're kind of left with, like, does he give the money? But, like, they're like, this person isn't important. He's there for two lines, and then it's all about this guy. And I think that was pretty cool.
It's the fucking, it's like a 3-minute song, and it has such a deep narrative to it that it's like interesting to listen to. It's super cool. Shout out to Hank Williams, I guess. Fuck.
Yeah, and that's something that I noticed throughout this whole thing is that these songs are much more story-driven than theme-driven. Mm-hmm. It's much more of telling a little vignette with each song. And I assume that's just that way of songwriting. I think that's really cool because you just don't see that as much anymore. So it's usually like really unique to have a song that's its own encapsulated story rather than presenting an idea or about one person or thing. So I really enjoyed that. Hearing all these little stories, it felt very Western.
Yeah. And the, like, my favorites on the record, definitely Folsom Prison Blues. That is an absolute classic. If you meet someone that doesn't like that song, fucking throw them in a ditch. Cocaine Blues, that was, I, the line where he's like, "I'm glad I shot that old bitch down," or whatever. It's like, oh my God, that's so funny. That bad bitch down, yeah. It's like, oh my God, that's hilarious. And then 25 Minutes Ago, that has interesting harmonic movement in it. Because as the song progresses, it fucking modulates downward until it reaches 1 minute. And it's like, oh, fucking dude, what the hell? Johnny Cash, you're a clever man. Clever bastard, man. And I love the shrieks in that song. Oh, oh, oh. And his voice cracks and everything. It gives it like a real good, genuine feeling behind the song.
Yeah, and like it's such an interesting device of the like counting it down.
Mm-hmm.
But he fucking messes up the counting.
Did he does, yeah. He says like 4 and then 7 and then 3 or something.
He goes 5, 3, 7. I was like, motherfucker.
Yeah, I noticed that and I was like, did I hear that wrong? Or is Johnny Cash can't count? Is Johnny Cash can't count?
Is Johnny Cash can't count?
I think so.
Yeah.
Also, Johnny Cash, I actually don't know if he played the harmonica on that harmonica song. I can't remember the harmonica song for the life of me.
That's also a great line where he's like, I can play harmonica faster than kiss a duck's lips.
And he did. He fucking shredded it, man. Holy shit. Yeah. Oh my God. There's just so much fun to be had on this record, and even people like you or me who do not listen to country, do not listen to rockabilly, bluegrass music can have thorough enjoyment from this record.
Oh yeah, it's just fun, and his voice is just undeniably like good to listen to. He's such a good singer.
Jesus, man. Fuck. What I would do to have that man's voice. And I think he did it right as he hit, like, I don't know, this, I don't know much about Johnny Cash's discography, but I think this is like peak Johnny Cash vocals at this point. It's like he's kind of getting a little older and a little more raspier, and it's like, it's so fucking deep and like, oh my God, man. So good.
Yeah, it's definitely really good. And then he brings in that female vocalist. I never quite caught her name or whatever it was.
It was June Carter.
June Carter. She killed it as well. And Jackson, she's belting and it sounds so good. And their voices work really well together. It adds an interesting element where you have that like higher pitch now. Mm-hmm. And it totally changes like how the entire song sounds. It was really good.
And they even have that narrative back and forth between the two of them. Like, there's the narrative that they're a married couple, and it's like, fuck you, I'm going to Jackson. It's like, okay, fuck you, go to Jackson. It's like, totally hilarious and totally great.
Super good.
Oh, I want to talk about Flush from the Bathroom of Your Heart. That, all of those lyrics are so fucking clever. Like I think he actually wrote this song. And it's just a ton of metaphors back to back to back. It's like the elevator of your heart, and I've got shafted out of it or something.
Yeah.
And it's like puns and like dad jokes and like stupid shit. But I really, really enjoyed like pure metaphors just back to back. I thought that was fantastic.
Yeah, and like the way it's, you know, her heart is, it's the bathroom of her heart. It's like,
Yeah.
yeah, I'm gone, but it's kind of a bathroom in there. It's kind of poopy
It's
stinky,
kind of like a
so.
gas station 7-Eleven bathroom in here. Why don't you fucking clean this up, man?
Yeah, I actually wrote down a note as well about the elevator online. From the elevator of your heart,
Yeah.
I've been shafted. And it's
That
like, wow!
was. Oh man, it's so good. The only like problem slash non-problem I have with this record is that all of the songs structurally are the same. A lot of them are
Yeah.
either ballads or straight up like blues, rockabilly, chugga 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 songs. You know, with the snare going, the shit like that. But that doesn't really make this record any less great, I don't think. I think it plays perfectly into what he does and how he sounds.
Yeah, I think that helps because, like you said, a lot of it's similar, so you can kind of catch on to most of these songs after only a couple listens. I was singing along to the entire album by the end of the week, so I think it just adds to the catchiness, which is a factor here, and I think it is really great because it makes for like some easier listening, but also some interesting commentary with, you know, multiple songs. One that I noted, beyond just the whole prison thing, "Dark as the Dungeon," where it's like a condemnation of coal mining and how awful that is, and I'm like, that's wild to be like, this shit sucks. Don't do it.
It's fucking cool. And then he has that line in the middle of the song where he's like, "Guys, don't laugh." And then he laughs. It's like, it's really funny.
No laughing during the album, please.
Recording to Vert Columbia. He can't say things like, he can't say things like hell or shit.
Is that the word that gets bleeped out?
Yeah,
Because
I
I
think
couldn't
it's shit.
tell. Can't say hell or none of that. Probably bleep that one out.
I can't believe they actually redacted it. Maybe they did it because he said they would do it, so it's like a meta thing. Because they didn't bleep out "bad bitch" in Cocaine Blues, so
They didn't. Maybe he said fuck.
maybe he said "fuck shit piss little
He said the
bitch."
fuck word.
He said the fuck word, and Columbia was like, "No." All right. Anything else about this record?
Oh, I don't know if you would know what I'm talking about, but well, I grew up listening to modern country, you know that. And one of the songs that I heard was called "Ole Red," and it's just like it's one of those like vignette type story songs about like this guy with who is in prison, and he's sent, his job is to like run the dog, who's like this insane bloodhound who can catch anybody, and he gets it like a girlfriend, I think down south or something of the prison, and then escapes, and when they set the dog loose, or he like then starves it from the girlfriend, and then like he escapes, and when they let the dog loose, it runs down to its girlfriend, and he runs north or something like that. But the song "The Wall" reminded me of that. That's all.
That's a good one. There's so and like So I, when I listen to these records, I always have Genius up just to look at the lyrics. And it was a pain in the ass to navigate the songs because it would go from, you know, I would choose from the album list of songs at Folsom Prison live record, and it would go to the song the record is actually off of. So it was like going back and forth and back and forth between all these Johnny Cash records, and I was like, I just want to fucking find the fucking one I'm listening to. But that was a minor complaint, and it was also a little surprising to see how many songs he had actually written prior to this record about prison and prison life and the life of a prisoner. And I was
Yeah.
like, oh shit, I thought most of these songs were, I mean, a few of them are, but I thought most of them were written for the intention of performing them at prisons. But I guess not. He's just a prison-loving boy.
Just a good old boy.
And I like how he says darn. He says dern in 25 minutes ago. Darn, 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 darn. Okay, that's all.
Okay.
That's all. Let's fucking rate this record. What are you rating it?
I'm gonna, trying to move around. I'm gonna give this a solid 9 out of 10.
I will fucking agree with you. 9 out of 10. Beautiful. I think the only thing keeping it from a 10 out of 10 is everything is the same.
Yes. And it's most of the songs are pretty short. Like the track listing, mm-hmm. you see 2, 3, but like that includes him talking and stuff. So you're not going to get a like real long in-depth stories. No. Like I said, they're all vignettes. So they're short. They're not super long narratives.
Totally. It's not a fucking 70s prog like concept record or anything. Yeah. It's just Johnny Cash having a lot of fun, boy. Yeah.
All right, where are we putting this on this list? I want to say above A Love Supreme?
Yeah. Yeah, you can totally do that because you rated it a 9 as well as I rated it a 9. So I think that definitely puts it above that.
Sounds good. And that's our second row now. Our second column, I guess. So that's exciting.
Damn, boy. We listen to a lot of records. Wow. Sorry, I have emphysema.
You have bitch is what you have.
You have bitch syndrome.
I hereby diagnose you with bitch.
It's terminal. Symptoms are include being a fucking massive bitch.
And that's what you have. You present with symptoms of bitch.
Symptoms of bitch. That's my EP coming out this fall. Symptoms of bitch. Okay. So we talked about the music. What about the movie, Joshua?
What about the movie? The movie this week. You had to know we were going to do this. You had to. You can't throw this up on Netflix and not expect a couple of dumbasses like us to not watch it. We got the 2019 drama crime thriller Uncut Gems. We got the Safdie brothers who wrote this and directed it. We got Adam Sandler.
It's an A24 film. It's our 700,000th A24 film.
Listen, I did not know. I did not have relations with A24. Shout out to our sponsor, did not A24. I really fucking, as soon as that logo comes on, like, I out loud was like, God damn it. I too. Need to stop picking A24 films because all of them have been the ones that I've picked.
Yep. Tisk tisk.
But, yeah, what did you think?
All right.
Do you think?
I'm going to be real with you, Chief. I think, therefore I am. And I think that this movie is fucking amazing. Absolutely, absolutely amazing. Oh my God. Why is Adam Sandler so good in this? Let's talk about that first. Okay?
Yes.
This man has been known and been trashed for releasing trash movies with Judd Apatow or whatever the fuck, Kevin James, Chris Rock, and his group of SNL cronies. And then he's just like, yeah, I'll do a fucking really, really good art film just because. Explain that to me. How does that happen?
I don't know. I think Jack and Jill 2 didn't get greenlit. So he just...
This movie was actually originally supposed to be Jack and Jill 2. Oh, also, fucking spoilers. If you haven't seen this movie, go watch it. It's on Netflix. Yes. No excuse. Spoiler warning. Everyone, get the frick out if you haven't seen it. Go watch it. Come back.
Go get it. Go watch.
Because this is the first movie that has been, like, very new that we've watched.
Yes, this was... Was this up for, awards?
Like I don't know. I honestly have no idea.
It was nominated for a few Gotham Awards, I see. I don't think so.
Independent Spirit Awards?
That sounds like a cigarette. Anyways, yeah, this movie is, it is pretty recent, so you should probably watch it. And it is pretty plot driven too. So if you haven't seen it, this is probably not gonna make a lot of sense. But yeah, this fucking movie was it was a lot. It was a lot to handle. This movie is like having a heart attack for 2 hours,
It's fucking
and you get
sick.
like a half hour break at the hour 15 mark.
Oh man. I just love the adrenaline rush of a lot of those scenes. Like, okay, I just want to talk about my favorite scene in the whole movie. It might be yours too. It's the one where he's getting 500 phone calls at the same time, and he's trying to do a whole bunch of shit, and people are trying to get into the store, and people are trying to do this, do that. And he's trying to sort out the gem, and he's trying to do this, and blah, 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 blah. And he's talking to this bitch, and he's doing this, and he's blah, 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 blah. The way that it just conveys a sense of chaos is astounding. I don't understand how they did it in terms of technicality. But oh boy, it made my adrenal gland go.
Yeah,
So,
I
yeah.
mean, I think my favorite scene would probably be that last basketball game as
That
it's
was
going between him in the shop and Arno and Phil in the like vestibule, and she's at the like sports booking place, and there's the guy that she's talking to, and then the room that she goes up to, and
They're
I thought
chasing her,
that was
and
pretty
yeah, oh
good.
my God, that was another X. Yeah, fuck.
Yeah. And then speaking of that, like we said, spoilers. Let's talk about the ending of this movie.
Okay,
Did you like the
yeah,
ending?
I actually really enjoyed the ending because of, I didn't expect it, but in the back of my mind, I kind of expected something would go wrong. But I think the way they did it was actually super tasteful. It wasn't like super dramatic. Slow motion, boom, oh, he shot, oh my God, oh. It was just like matter of fact, like how it would have actually happened. And I think it was beautifully done. I actually really like the ending. And the last shot, oh my God, that last shot was fucking awesome, where it like goes into the bullet wound and then it goes through the rock and it goes into the stars. And it's like, whoa, Adam Sandler was the stars the whole
Adam Sandler was The Rock the whole time.
Yeah,
This
dude.
movie stars Dwayne The Rock Johnson in his
Yeah.
death house. What? That's interesting, because I didn't like the ending.
Oh, really?
That was my least favorite part of this whole movie. I thought, when he, after the auction, I felt like that would have been a good place to end it. I like what they did with the rest, but it felt. I think just because of how stressful this movie is and how non-stop like chaos, I was tired. Like,
Yeah.
an hour and a half in, and it kind of comes to a slow point, and I kind of just wanted it to end there because it's like I can't take much more of this shit. And then they have that really good scene of the basketball game, and the ending, I don't know, it just felt kind of short, because like it also just I don't know why did he shoot him? Like, he was angry.
He
Like,
was
this
trapped in a
guy's,
vestibule for, you know how long a basketball game is? It's just like 4 hours long.
but like
And he was gonna kill him anyways. And it was like, he's a fucking psychopath.
I don't know, it just seems weird that this guy, who's clearly the biggest muscle in this organized crime, would just do that. Like, this, it seems like something you would expect from someone lower in this organization, but.
No, but it kind of sets his character up to do that. Like, it sets him up as this fucking guy who basically just wants to kill Adam Sandler from the beginning of the fucking movie. And the only thing that's stopping him is the boss.
But then he
Arno?
doesn't stop him.
Ardo?
Yeah, Arno. But then, like, I don't know.
Yeah.
It just seems so, like, dumb to be like. He just got 1.2. He just won a $1.2 million is what Adam Sandler just got, how he just got. And then they're like, "Nah, we're just gonna steal like this jewelry." And it's like, what the fuck? Like, I know he's not brains, but like, you would think that he would have enough brain to be like, "We can get this 1.2 million totally legally and have to face nothing, or we can shoot this guy and rob this store." and now there's you know, eventually two bodies, and it's like that's gonna come back to you way more than just being mad at him. And like, just I don't, just punch him. I get being mad at him. Walk up and hit him. You do that all the time.
Ugh. Yeah.
It was just like kind of dumb to do that, and then the movie ends like 5 minutes later, and I was like, okay.
That's interesting.
It's just, I felt unsatisfied. They didn't let me come.
Put it in the comments, guys. Who's right?
Me or Josh? Obviously me, because that's a good ending, and I liked it. Because, okay. How else would they have, well, besides it, them ending it at the auction or whatever, how would they have resolved that inherent conflict and rage of that character? Like, how would, like, sure, he punches him in the face, happy ending for everybody. He goes to the Ritz-Carlton in this, and that. It's boring. That sucks.
How about this? He opens the door, and they're like threatened to beat him up or whatever. Like, say they do go further, like he presses him up and he has the gun on him, but Arno like gets him down and he actually listens instead of shooting him, and then they like force him at gunpoint to go to the place and meet her, or like they wait for her, and then they get there, inspect the money, shoot them both and leave. And maybe they shoot them both and like break the things but don't take anything, or just take a little bit or whatever, and then leave to make it seem like a robbery or something. Like, I don't know, it just seems not very organized crime for that to happen.
Yeah, and you could definitely see points in Arno's character of weakness. You can definitely see, like, when they're dangling him out the window, you can see the look on Arno's face. He's like, oh my god, like, what the fuck do I do? He's, like, obviously incapable of handling all this pressure at once.
Yeah. I mean, I guess that's, with organized crime, the best stories are when someone fucks up. Like, with Goodfellas, the main guy had it going good. Yeah. And then it was the main character, I forgot all their names, but the guy running the family had it going good, and then it was just the one drug problem that brought down all of them.
Yep. Yep.
So I guess, I don't know, I guess that's just a story that I haven't seen too much, but
leave it in the comments, guys. Who's right, who's wrong?
Give it a thumbs up. Let's smash that MF like button. I want to get I'm not doing this bit.
I hate 10 likes.
I hate it when people do this bit.
Guys, if you don't smash that MF like button, I will be in your room at 3:30 a.m. and I will be explaining to you why the ending of Uncut is bad.
So let's talk about the other actors in this movie, because there's so many great performances. Fucking Kevin Garnett is awesome in this movie.
Yeah.
Holy shit. I did not think Kevin Garnett had acting chops, but he totally did. It was super convincing.
Yeah, he was good. The Weeknd wasn't bad.
Yeah, I liked his little cameo thing. That was great.
Yeah, it was a weird little side story, but it was like cool, and it was like, yeah, that's just actually The Weeknd, and that's just actually Kevin Garnett.
Yeah.
And like,
I think that's the best part, is that it's actually the people. Like, it seems realistic. Well, not realistic, but it seems like it could happen.
Right. I almost was like, is this based on a true story? Like, I was waiting for something to come up, like, based off of a true story.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's just, like, I don't know, who would think to put Kevin Garnett in a movie if it wasn't something that actually happened? Like,
yeah.
How would you think of this story if it didn't actually happen?
Yeah. It's kind of...
Oh my god, this...
Fucking bizarre.
This movie premiered at Telluride.
Oh shit, really? That's cool.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. Damn, that's sick.
Yeah, those guys were cool. Fucking all... Everyone was good.
Yeah, I don't have a single complaint about any of the performances, honestly. I actually really enjoyed Adele Dazeeb's performance as just the bitchy fucking wife. Oh my god, she played that so perfect. Like that one scene at when they're having the Passover dinner and she has her bat mitzvah dress on, and she's just like, your face looks so fucking stupid. It's like, she's like actually laughing at him to his face, and it's, oh my god, that was perfectly written, perfectly done by the writers and Idina Menzel. I didn't think Elsa would have it in her, but she did.
It was, yeah, good. And the girl who played Julia was really good. The sex scene was really uncomfortable to watch with my family.
Oh god, you watched this with your family? That's terrible.
Yeah, I did.
Okay, all right, let's talk about Julia Fox. I don't think that might be the fattest ass I've ever seen in the history of cinema. I had to like take a, like, I was sitting down, but I had to take a step back while I was sitting down just to be like, Jesus fuck. It's like 3D. It was like coming out at me. It was speaking to me.
What'd it say?
It's like, enjoy the movie. No, but Jesus Christ, was she attractive? Oh my fucking god. Like, think. I'm glad they got someone very, very pretty and nice to look at for prolonged, for a long time.
Yeah, I mean, you kind of need it when you have Adam Sandler's character looks gross. All of the people in the organized crime look gross.
Mm-hmm. Kevin Garnett looks good.
Yeah, he looks good, but it's like. And Damani, he didn't look bad either, but like the one pawn shop he goes to where he gives the
oh my god,
the ring,
yeah,
that guy just looks like he's asleep, and you're like, what? Oh my god, Arno. I literally wrote down, why does Arno look so gross?
Arno, like, he looks like he's about to die. He looks like he's made of salami or prosciutto or something. He looks like he's made of deli meat.
Yeah. And okay, fucking, I know it's because it was set in 2012. I don't know what's happening with my throat, but fucking iOS 6 is so gross. I'm so used to 7 just seeing that again.
Yeah.
And they interact with their phones so much, and I'm glad that they used the actual iOS they would, mm-hmm. but I was like, I hate looking at that.
It was kind of cool, and it was kind of like, I like how it wasn't like a stupid fake ass.
Yeah.
Operating system, like a lot of movies do, to get out of. I know it's expensive or whatever, but it's like, it takes you out of a movie for a second when it's like, text.os, snap fuck, whatever. Book chat. But it was super, super genuine. And like, when you see the scenes of like Adam Sandler trying to text somebody, you can actually see him like fuck up the texts, and he texts like a fucking old man, and it's like, really, it was perfect. He fucking even did the texts good. Adam Sandler, come on.
Good job. Good text.
You're making me so confused. Like, why are you so good at acting sometimes?
Well, and his whole character was confusing, cuz it's like, mm-hmm. he's this main character, but he's a fucking asshole the whole movie.
Oh yeah,
like he just berates the girl at the auction, the front desk girl. And he's such an asshole. I'm like, Jesus Christ, God. He has to be such a dick to everyone he meets.
But I actually wrote this down. He was a fucking floor mat to his wife and then the rest of his family. And anyone who posed like a physical threat or like, you know, emotional threat towards him, he was a fucking most passive beta cuck male ever.
Yeah. He wouldn't stand up to anyone and then just take out, I'm guessing, all of that on everyone else.
Definitely.
But
I'm
like, I hate this character so much, but I'm like rooting for him, kind of.
Or yeah. Just,
I'm interested to see what happens, I guess.
I think that's the best way to put it. I think you're sympathetic to like, dude winning $1 million or like getting gypped out of $1 million and being chased by the mafia wouldn't be so cool.
Yeah, I don't know. It sounds kind of not epic.
Not epic to me.
I'm just gonna say. You know what's something that was bad?
What was bad?
At the very beginning, when they're looking in the gem, and then it transitions to just the spacey computer effects.
Yeah.
Most of the time it's seamless, except the first time you can see exactly where it switches from the gem to the effects.
Oh, really? I didn't know this.
All of the other ones are seamless, and the ending one was actually dope. I liked that a lot. Yeah. And like when they did it, but like the first time it goes in, you can see this little like jump.
Oh shit.
And I was like,
I literally wrote down, I was like, dude, that opening transition was fucking sick. This is gonna be a good movie.
Yeah, overall though, super cool transition, and like I really liked what they did with it. Just the one moment I was like,
yeah,
oh, I saw that.
Huh, I'll have to watch it again and see if I can catch that. That's funny.
It also could have just been like my TV or something, I don't know.
Let's talk about the fucking dialogue of this movie and how much how amazing it is. Oh my god. It's so good. Everyone's talking over each other. It sounds like it's fucking real life, and like everyone's having different conversations within this conversation, and they're talking to people around them, and they're like, "Eh, I want to hit you." Like the perfect example is like when he goes to the Weekend concert, and he's trying to confront what's his name? Damani, yeah. And he's like, oh, here's this guy I want you to meet. And oh, here's this other thing. And here's this. And then he's like trying to talk to him over the fucking Weekend concert. And it's like so well written. And so there's probably a lot of improvisation involved too. And it just seems so seamless and perfect. I loved it.
Yeah, it's, I mean, it's crazy. Like, and how consistent they are with it. Talking over each other and just going back and forth, like really quickly, it adds so much to that sense of tension. Like, I think that's where a lot of it comes from. It's just like when Kevin Garnett's trying to buy the rock, the first time he brings it out to him, and they're just going back and forth. And it's like hardcore argument where no one is finishing a sentence, and you're like, ah!
It's so cool. It's so cool. Oh my God. Yeah. It's so chaotic and it's just perfect. It suits the tone of the movie excellently. Oh my god. You know what else suits the tone of the film perfectly? The fucking score. Her ass. Well, her ass, of course. The score. Holy shit balls. It's fucking amazing score. Did you notice that?
No.
What? So fucking cool. Like, there was these parts of, like, you know, there's like cool drive ass synth parts, and then there's like these fucking Mongolian chants and shit happening, and then there's like really cool fucking strings and weird tonalities, and you know, there's synth and strings, and it's like perfectly set to what's happening in the movie and what Adam Sandler's doing, and it's so good. That's all.
I don't doubt it was good. I just didn't notice it. I'm so bad at paying attention to score. The only time I notice it are when it's like exceptionally good or exceptionally bad. I'm so bad at noticing when it's just like good or bad or in the middle or something like that.
If you watch this movie again, pay close attention, because it's fucking sick. It's really cool.
Yeah, I gotta give myself like a month to recover first.
I gotta go to the hospital, man. I had a fucking coronary.
I get the fucking defib ready. Clear. Anything else?
I don't. Adam Sandler sexting might be the funniest thing ever.
No, that was uncomfortable. I was sitting there next to my parents, and it's like, how wet are you right now? And I'm like, don't answer that.
He says, I'm going to come twice, maybe three times in the movie. Which is excellent.
You know what? He says the fuck word.
He did.
And Johnny Cash tried to say the fuck word. So I guess Adam Sandler is better than Johnny Cash?
Yeah, I think so.
That's how it works, right?
Yeah. Was Johnny Cash in Uncut Gems? I don't think so.
Oh, but he said the fuck word.
Another thing I wanted to talk about. The violence in the movie.
Yeah.
I loved that. Like, how awkward and stupid it looked. Because that's how it actually is. Like, people slap each other and don't know how to fucking... Like, they're not choreographed
fucking ninjas. Like, they try to grapple each other, and like, they're like that scene in the car where he's at his kids' play, and you know, he throws them in the back of the car, and they're just like fucking strangling and struggling, and like, so good, so genuine, so perfect. Mwah. Good job, yeah. Sad Fee Brothers.
Yeah, the violence was really cool, and they really were not afraid to like show the damage either, like afterwards. Mm-hmm. I thought that was really neat. It lent itself, like you said, to like, it felt like a real person.
Yeah,
just because you're like, you know, you saw him get beat up, and then you saw like wounds and gashes, and it wasn't downplayed or upplayed. It wasn't like the super gory, you know, it wasn't the drive scene where she gets her head blown to smithereens. Yeah. But it also wasn't like a Disney Channel thing where they have a Band-Aid on their face or something. Like, yeah. It was a really nice medium. I thought they walked that line really well.
Totally. Okay. That's about it from me. Let's rate this sumbitch.
You go first.
I think this is a 10 out of 10 for me. I think this is a modern classic. This is a good fucking movie. Excellent fucking movie.
I think it was pretty good, but I just think it's hard to watch with just how stressful it is. And like I said, I didn't love the ending. I'm going to have to give this a 8 out of 10.
That's fair.
Still okay. Pretty good. Like I said, I enjoyed it overall.
If you gave anything less than an 8, I would have had to strangle you. Contract.
I consider it a 7.
Good thing, boy. Good thing, boy. Okay, so on the list, I think... Since we didn't unanimously agree on a 10 out of 10, it can't go above Good, Bad, and the Ugly.
No, I would put it right below Drive.
Really? I'd put it above Drive.
It's just how, I don't know, this sounds like lame, but like it's just so hard to watch. It is so stressful. I watched a short like this once. It's like 23 minutes. It's so fucking stressful.
But that just shows you how effective everything is to make you feel so stressed out. Like in Drive, there's like moments of suspense and everything, but it's not like this nonstop visceral experience coming from a fucking movie.
But I liked that because then I can go back to it anytime. I don't have to like mentally prepare to watch it.
Because like you have a baby brain. Baby brain.
Well, the baby brains, lots of people have baby brains.
They're so cool. Okay, fine. Drive is an excellent movie. You can put it underneath Drive, I suppose. But wait, is Drive underneath Good, the Bad, and the Ugly?
Yeah, it's right underneath.
Okay.
That it puts it in between Drive and Inglourious Basterds.
Yeah. Okay. I'm good with that.
Yeah, you are. You're my bitch boy.
So yeah, everyone go watch the movie. Fuckers. It's good.
Yeah. We both clearly enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm.
Highly recommend. So... All right. Well, that was this week.
Fuck yeah.
Next week, I have the album this week.
Yeah,
and figured we would do another new genre dive. This one was something I had not ever heard of until just today. I have to look up how to say this again because we're gonna listen to our first non-English piece of art.
Motherfuckers.
And so we're going to listen to a genre. I don't know if you've heard of this. It's called Soviet Wave.
Oh, yeah. I've heard of Soviet Wave. That's cool.
Yeah. So for those that don't know, Soviet Wave is this style of music that combines like vaporwave with like goth. And it all comes out of the former Soviet Union. So the band we're going to listen to is called Molchatoma. And the album... is pronounced etaji, as Google Translate tells me. It means floors. If you look up Molchat Doma, MOLCHATDOMA, it's their like most popular one. It looks like stairs, I think. Let me pull up the cover again. But yeah, this album has gained some traction on TikTok is how I found it. Because people love to, like, dance to it and stuff. It's, like, a weird building.
Okay. Just send me the name of it after.
Yeah, I'll send you the Spotify link after. Because, <Yeah. laughs> like, literally all the songs, they are not Russian. They're Belarusian.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'll be super fun. I like the 80s shit. So, for the movie next week.
For the movie.
I had it down to two, and I think I'm going to pick... Okay. We're going to watch 2016 Best Picture winner, Moonlight.
Ooh.
I have never seen this movie, and you haven't either?
No, I haven't.
And I think it'd be perfect, considering the times that we live in. And some people liked it, obviously, because it's the Best Picture winner. So it's got to be good.
What did it beat out again? Wasn't there like...
It was La La Land. It was that whole
That's
thing.
That's what it was. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah, because they announced it wrong.
Mm-hmm. The fucking geriatric, like, 98-year-old people fucking announcing that Best Picture winner. And the bald guy comes out and he's like, Moonlight, you won. Yeah, that was funny. And also the worst thing to watch ever.
Well, that'll be fun.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for listening to us ramble and Lane be wrong. We will see you again next week with Mocha Thoma's Itachi and 2016's Moonlight. Go subscribe to us on YouTube. Hit subscribe and like and turn on notifications so you don't miss any episodes. Follow us on Instagram, oneforTheOther.podcast. And send us some freaking suggestions.
Yeah. Dog. What the heck? What the heck, people? We're going to run out of movies by the time... What the frick?
There's no more movies. We need them. So email them to us. oneforTheOtherPodcast@gmail.com. And just, yeah, tell us what you want. We'll give you a little shout out if you want. And we'll totally do that. Just anything you want us to listen to or watch. That's as an LP and feature length. Yes. Pretty much the only thing.
Yes. All right, everybody. Go do all those things. Go do.
Yeah.
We'll see you next week. Right. Bitches.